It is my great pleasure to introduce the speaker for class two, who is a pioneer in the emerging field of synthetic biology. Raised on a corn farm in Harvard, Nebraska, he has discovered new ways to harness the power of nature to address several of the major challenges of our era. By engineering the DNA of genes of microorganisms, he creates cell factories for the production of organic compounds that are too complicated to manufacture efficiently and cheaply through traditional methods of organic synthetic chemistry. As he says, his goal is to engineer the cell to become a chemical reactor. And that's exactly what he's done. Indeed, his laboratory are now world leaders in this new field of metabolic engineering. What they've done is to advance biofuel production by microorganisms, relieving a lot of the demand on gasoline. He has also greatly extended a major advance in the discovery of antimalarials. 2UU received the Nobel Prize in 2015 for finding the antimalarial artemisinin. It required exacting extraction from plants to get enough of this compound. And what Jay has done is to develop ways to engineer yeast to produce this compound in massive amounts, cheaply, efficiently, so it can be disseminated worldwide. This is the first real treatment for malaria. Moreover, his lab has developed ways to use microorganisms to degrade microenvironmental contaminants, like pesticides in our environment. For these remarkable accomplishments, he's won numerous awards, including the E&I Renewable Energy Prize, the Heinz Award for Technology, the Economy, and Employment, and he has been named by Discover Magazine as the Scientist of the Year. Please join me in welcoming the Senior Faculty Scientist, Associate Lab Director for Biosciences, and Howe Distinguished Professor of Biochemical Engineering at the University of California, Berkeley, and Chief Executive Officer and Vice President of Fuels Synthesis at the Joint BioEnergy Institute, Jay Keasling.
Thanks very much. It's a pleasure to be here, and it's an honor to be able to speak for my fellow inductees in biological sciences. So as you've heard, my experience with biology started at a very young age. I was raised on a corn farm in Nebraska. My father grew corn, soybeans, raised pigs and cattle. As a young boy, every evening I came home from school to do an hour or two of chores, feeding the cattle, watering the pigs, laying out irrigation pipe. And on Saturday afternoons, my father made me clean the pig pens with a shovel. From the time I was 8 years old until I left the farm at 18, I had the smell of pig manure on my hands. When I left to go to college, my father sold the pigs because he had no one to scoop the manure. As you can see, I have a lot of practical experience with biology. I was 8 years old when the first genetic engineering experiments were published, and I remember reading a few years later about the founding of a company called Genentech. I was fascinated by the potential to engineer life. Although I went to college with the idea of becoming a medical doctor, my first genetics course rekindled my fascination with genetics, with genetic engineering, and drove me down a completely different path, one that I'm still on today. My area of research is biological engineering or synthetic biology. My colleagues and I seek to create tools to manipulate biology in a highly controlled and reproducible manner, and then to use those tools to solve some of the world's most important challenges in human health, environment, and energy. Our ability to engineer biology has accelerated by leaps and bounds over the last four decades. Since the advent of genetic engineering, we've sequenced a significant but still small fraction of the world's genomes. We can insert or delete genes into genomes of almost any organism. We can simulate biological systems on the computer, predict their behavior to changes in their genomes. We can design and construct new genomes from scratch. We can build tissues and organs from a single progenitor cell. In just four decades, biological engineering has had a tremendous impact on society, and nowhere is it more evident than in agriculture. When I was on the farm in the 70s, that period was the height of chemistry's impact on agriculture. The seeds my father planted in fields were hybrids that were created using traditional crop breeding, but they were covered in noxious chemicals to keep the rodents and other pests from eating the seeds in the ground. Farmers sprayed noxious chemicals on the crops from the tractor and from airplanes, and the pesticides and the fertilizers leached from the fields into the groundwater. And I left the farm in the 80s. As I left the farm in the 80s, genetically modified crops began to appear. Corn and soy was engineered to be resistant to relatively innocuous chemicals like Roundup, and to be resistant to corn borers and other pests, so many noxious chemicals were no longer needed. The amount of energy needed to farm decreased dramatically relative to that used in the chemicals era. Wildlife partially came back to the farm, and nationally, crop yields have increased dramatically. We are now advancing into an era where microbiomes in the soil are being added or co-cultivated with the crops to increase yields. Biological engineering has had a tremendous impact on agriculture, but it has not yet solved some of the most important problems. 1% of the world's energy still is being consumed to produce nitrogen-based fertilizers to fertilize largely corn produced on U.S. farms. 1% of the world's energy. We spread a huge amount of phosphate-based fertilizer on the ground, and it's now limiting in the world, with only a small fraction taken up by crops because it's not in a form that plants can easily take up. And weeds have acquired resistance to Roundup. And the plants are relatively inefficient in photosynthesis and require large inputs of water. In theory, these challenges can be solved with biological engineering. The world faces many other problems, problems created by our generation and the generations before us. We've consumed our natural resources, we've polluted our water, land, and air, and people are needlessly dying because they can't get access to high-quality, low-cost pharmaceuticals. Biology has the potential to solve many of these problems. We can engineer plants and microbes to produce renewable carbon neutral transportation fuels. We can engineer plants and microbes to clean up the environment. We can prospect the biological diversity of the planet for new drugs and diseases and produce those drugs affordably. And eventually, we'll be able to effectively engineer humans to eliminate genetic disease. But solving these challenges requires an understanding of basic biology. We need to know how cells grow and divide, how enzymes inside cells catalyze reactions and build the basic molecules of life. We need to know how plants capture the energy of sunlight, fix carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, and turn that fixed carbon into more plant material. We need to know how microbes in the soil and in our guts interact with us and with other multicellular organisms. We need to know how organisms can survive and thrive in extreme environments, and we need to know how the brain works. We need to know how a changing environment will affect the growth and proliferation of all organisms on the planet. This basic science does not need any other justification than curiosity itself. We, and I mean me, are sometimes so focused on solving problems that we forget that the technology we have in our phones, our gas tanks, our medicines, and even our clothes was built on a foundation of basic science and serendipity. The United States has been a leader in its support of basic science, and in particular of basic biology. Unfortunately, our government doesn't always support basic science in a manner that will ensure that the United States remains at the technological cutting edge. We, as scientists and engineers, must be willing to speak with policymakers and the public to help them understand the science and how some seemingly far-fetched pursuits could have unknown and outsized impact. Finally, we need smart regulation of technology. The United States is one of the few places where biological engineering can be practiced, particularly for agriculture in the way it is. We must not take that technological and scientific freedom for granted. Regulation lags far behind technological development, and the stakes are too high in biological engineering for something to go awry. Scientists should not shy away from participating in the development of regulation. Rather, we should embrace it and participate in a dialogue in an unbiased and meaningful way. Through smart regulation and public support, biology will continue to be one of the most exciting areas of basic science, will continue to grow as a fraction of the U.S. economy, and will make the world a better place. Again, I'm deeply honored to be inducted into the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Thank you.